Hi there. Welcome to another edition of Jamaica Magazine. I'm Adrian Atkinson. In today's show, we'll share updates on major infrastructure work on the Mandela Highway, plus tips for back-to-school shopping on a budget. And later, see how you can help protect the population against diseases. Sit back and relax with these and more to come as we turn the pages of Jamaica Magazine.
If you don't wear your seatbelt, this could happen to you. And the consequences could be disastrous. In an accident, the vehicle stops. Suddenly, you don't. Even at 30 miles per hour, your body will be thrown violently forward with a crash force of up to 10 times your weight. Always wear a seatbelt. Seatbelts save lives.
Major infrastructure work is taking place on the Mandela Highway to create a more safe and efficient roadway. The work, which will increase the number of lanes and improve travel time, is about 50% complete. Let's take a look.
Major infrastructure improvement work along the Mandela Highway between the east-west toll road on and off ramp and 6 miles is far advanced. Since the construction began in August 2016, major work has been done, including the addition of a stabilizing base structure for sections of the road to avoid base failure due to the geology of the land. Lifting of sections of the roadway that's prone to flooding is also proceeding. A section of the eastbound road between the ferry police station and the off-ramp was closed to facilitate improved drainage work and subgrade work. This also involved shifting of the traffic to the southern side, where two temporary lanes were created while work to lift the road on the northern side takes place.
Having done the subgrade work between the Fresh River and the off-ramp to the east-west toll road, we are going to be moving quickly to putting in the base and to pave so that we can shift the traffic back onto the original alignment, meaning the eastbound traffic that is on the alignment that they have been accustomed to using, to make way for similar work on the westbound side.
The majority of the work for the new Fresh River Bridge and Dehaney River Box Culvert is complete, and similar progress is being made on an overpass bridge to connect the ferry community access roads.
We have one other bridge that we will have to build, that is to facilitate the Dehaney River, that's near to 6 miles.
Meanwhile, the eastern and western approaches to the new Fresh River Bridge is being filled to bring it up to level and to make the structure more stable. This work on the approaches also allows for easier access to the structure for further work, which includes launching of the girders that will form the base for the bridge decking.
The girders are what the deck of the structures will sit on. They are beams, in other words, that go across the river, and then we put up formwork, pour concrete, and that will then form part of the road, allowing for some time for that to cure, and then we'll be able to have traffic, well, at least construction traffic for starters, going across the structure.
Construction of the girders for both the Fresh River and overpass bridges is progressing and is expected to be launched in short order.
Several of them would have been completed already. Some 28 are to be constructed, and I believe more than 50% of those would have been done already.
The building of two of three abutments for the overpass bridge has already been completed, with work on the third to form the southern abutment still underway. After the steel fabrication work and pouring of concrete for this structure, the way would then be clear for the construction team to start the process of launching the girders for the bridge deck. Traffic has been shifted to the northern side in the vicinity of the overpass bridge as work proceeds on this structure. Also among the latest changes is the closure of the northern section of the Mandela Highway between the ferry community and the John Pringle Road for the eastbound traffic. Traffic has since been shifted to a queue ramp created in this vicinity to allow for work to take place on the eastbound corridor between the ferry community and the John Pringle Road.
This has now made it possible for us to continue with the soil nourishing, which is the drilling down of holes in sections of the Mandela, which we then mix the earth with cement, and that forms piles on which the embankment will sit. So what we're in effect doing is stabilizing the area, because we know of the possibility of failures taking place, and we want to prevent such happening.
Solid jersey barriers are being installed.
The project is slated to be completed by August of next year, and based on the accomplishments to date, we believe that that timeline will hold true. The critical things that need to be done, they are being done, and we don't foresee any major challenges going forward.
The government of Jamaica, enabling safe, efficient, and modern roads to support Jamaica's growth and prosperity.
If you're watching the JIS, you're always in the know when it comes to government information. Keep watching, keep informed, and tell your friends. JIS, your number one source for government info.
Back to school preparation by parents and guardians should by now be at its peak. And knowing how to make the most of the money you have to spend is quite a de-stressor. To help with that, in this next feature, the Consumer Affairs Commission shares tips on shopping for back to school supplies and where to look for its textbook price survey.
Shopping for back to school can be a challenge for many parents, and it does in fact affect their pockets. So how can they get what they need, but at the same time stay within their budget? We're at the Consumer Affairs Commission to get some vital tips to help you. Communications specialist at the Consumer Affairs Commission, CAC, Dorothy Campbell, has a wealth of knowledge on this matter. And so we put the question to her. What's the most important thing parents can do when seeking to shop for back to school on a budget?
What we ask them to do is to plan ahead. So you plan by collecting a list from the schools of exactly what is required. You plan your transportation route, if you're driving, if you're taking the bus. And you also plan how much you have to spend. So you use that list to prioritize what are the needs, what are the wants, what are the must-haves for the first couple of weeks at school. And then from then you determine what is the total cost and how much you have to spend.
Okay, so plan and prioritize. But how do parents even go about deciding the needs from the wants?
The CAC recommends that the parents divide the needs. So you'll have the needs that are, say, uniforms, school shoes, bags, that kind of thing. But you also have some needs prior to getting into school, which are medical examinations, eye tests, because your child might need glasses. You know, some of those things that you might have to do prior to going into back to school shopping. And then you determine what is the best option. Do you need to buy a new pair of school shoes the first month or the first 6 weeks of school? But I think what parents are going to focus mostly on is getting the kids ready in terms of their books. So those are some of the things that we say, try and go get those books first, and then determine whether you'll need newer items like shoes and socks and belts and epaulets and ties and so on. But those are necessary if it's a new school. But if it's a repeat, if you're going back to your old school, you just need to top up, maybe a new uniform, or repair the shoes or something like that.
A good reminder that not everything needs to be new. Perhaps one of the most painstaking challenges for back to school is dealing with the matter of textbook shopping.
The biggest thing on our brag list is our annual textbook survey. And we've been doing it for 20 years. So the research unit is, they're really efficient at this. So that's what we do every year. And we use that to help consumers to go to the website for those who have access and or call the CAC to get information about where the books are available, what is the average price for those books and so on.
In addition to the survey, there's also a price comparison tool.
The price comparison tool is available on our website and you can go in, select the items, fill your basket based on what you have to spend and determine exactly whether you want to get your science books from this particular store because the prices are low.
In addition to all of that, a tried and true tested way of cutting costs is getting used books. Many schools, churches, and other organizations often undertake book drives that you could look into.
So you can get some of those books at reduced prices.
And don't be afraid to ask around.
Ask your friends, where did you get the khaki uniforms? Where did you get the shoes? Where did you get, you know, these supplies? And you compare those prices to the stores that are either closer to home or closer to your office or your job.
Any other advice, any other tips that you want to share?
Don't get overwhelmed by the book list or by the requirements. Just try to prepare that child for the first 2 weeks of school. Just think about the first 2 weeks of school and get him ready.
So you heard, you can get your back-to-school necessities but still stay within budget. For more information, you can contact the Consumer Affairs Commission or simply visit their office right here at 34A Trafalgar Road, New Kingston.
Parents, make sure the children get immunized. Hear this! Immunization, it is a must. This is not a joke thing, this you can trust. It is required by law for entry to nursery, to daycare and to schools. Listen up, it is necessary to prevent diseases such as the measles, the poliomyelitis, the lockjaw and the whooping cough. Immunize your kids, keep them healthy, keep them strong. Prevent deadly diseases such as mumps, rubella and diphtheria. Immunize your child today. Immunization, a key to good health.
A message from the Ministry of Health and PAHO.
In getting ready for sending your children back to school, an important consideration must be how to maintain their good health as they will be able to learn and grow. So, is your child fully immunized?
Immunization is arguably one of the most cost-effective healthcare interventions ever invented. Since the first successful vaccine was developed to treat smallpox in 1796, vaccination has been preventing illnesses and deaths for millions of people around the world. According to the World Health Organization, about 2 to 3 million deaths are prevented each year because of persons taking up vaccines or being immunized. Through vaccination, smallpox was declared eradicated from the world in 1980, and that's a significant achievement.
Jamaica had the last case, for example, of polio in 1982. The last case of locally transmitted measles in 1991. The last case of diphtheria in 1995. The last case of rubella in 2000. And the last case of newborn tetanus in 2001.
In 2011, the country recorded 100% immunization coverage for BCG or tuberculosis. Thanks to the expanded program on immunization EPI, which began in 1976, the population coverage against vaccine-preventable diseases remains relatively high. Under the program, immunization coverage for children under 2 years old reached 93% to 94% in 2010-2011. The expanded program on immunization provides free vaccination to children ages 0 to 7 during the routine immunization schedule of the Ministry of Health. This is an integral strategy to reduce child mortality and morbidity.
First, we give at birth up to 6 weeks of age BCG vaccine, which is given usually in the hospital setting, and BCG protects against tuberculosis. At 6 weeks, 3 months, and 6 months, babies are due a vaccine against polio, which prevents poliomyelitis, as well as the pentavalent vaccine or the 5-in-1 vaccine.
Then at 12 months of age, the MMR vaccine is administered to protect children against measles, mumps, and rubella.
At 18 months, we give the first set of booster vaccines, and we give boosters again for MMR. the children get DPT as well, which is for diphtheria, pertussis and tetanus. And then they also get the polio vaccine at that time as well.
Between the ages of 4 to 6 years, children must get a second booster vaccine for DPT as well as a second booster vaccine for polio.
A lot of these vaccine preventable diseases are actually quite contagious and can cause death, especially among our young children. And so therefore, I would encourage parents to ensure that their children are appropriately vaccinated.
In Jamaica, children must be fully immunized before entry to school. And that is usually a part of mandatory school medicals due before the start of each academic year. Across the board, government is on a mission to improve the health of the nation by making traditional vaccines available and exploring new and non-traditional vaccines to tackle other diseases.
For example, the mitigation of NCDs like some cancers, which can be prevented through vaccinations such as the vaccine for the human papilloma virus, which causes cervical cancer, falls in line with the Ministry of Health's strategic plan to improve the offering to the public. And the commitment today is that we will work to ensure that other vaccines on the market with a proven track record are introduced as part of our routine administration to our population.
As early as the 1800s, Jamaica enjoyed a robust banana industry, and by 1866, the country began its export trade of the fruit. It was one of the top export produce and drivers of foreign exchange for the country. For years, the country and farmers alike enjoyed the success which saw up to 70,000 tons of banana being exported in 1993. But in the midst of this achievement were great challenges. The sector grappled with varying diseases and frequent storms and hurricanes, like Gilbert in 1988 and Charlie in 1951. The banana industry also had to face trade liberalization, falling prices, and low competitiveness. This triggered a gradual decrease in export. The final blow to the banana industry and to the livelihoods of many farmers was the passing of Hurricane Dean and Tropical Storm Gustav in 2007 and 2008. During this time, export fell to its lowest level. Some 800 jobs were lost with the closure of an estate in St. Thomas by a major stakeholder. Eventually, in 2008, the export of bananas stopped. With the support of the European Union, a long-standing partner, which provided funding, the government of Jamaica implemented programs to revive the banana sector. Between 2009 and 2011, priority was given to strengthening the technical and administrative support teams of the Banana Board. And it was during this period that the EU Banana Support Program was established. Funding to support the undertakings amounted to over 116 million Jamaican dollars by the government, as well as over 677,000 euros by the EU. This strategic approach to revitalize the banana industry would see production picking up and the resumption of export in 2011.
The EU has been a great partner. In fact, it's our largest partner in the government and certainly in the agriculture sector in terms of grant resources. And those resources have helped to support in a very significant way.
European Union has been supporting the banana sector since 1996, so it's not something new, and that commitment is very strong. We recognize the importance of bananas to Jamaican people and Jamaican culture. Unfortunately, the blow to the exports in 2008 has been quite difficult to recover from. So Today, we are trying to support the Banana Board and the Growers Association and the small producers in order to improve their competitiveness, but also to assist them with technical expertise, to look at a variety of different types of bananas and plantains.
Over the years, the help is more than 40 billion Jamaican dollars. We have benefited tremendously as recovery from risk management, from hurricanes. They provided tremendous help to recover each time when there's a disaster.
The revitalization of the industry saw the implementation of the Jamaica Banana Accompanying Measures, JBAM program in 2012. Approximately 1,400 farmers in banana producing parishes of St. Catherine, St. Thomas, Portland, St. Mary and St. James are targeted under the program. They are introduced to new varieties of the crop, notably the Fia. This type gives 30 to 50% more yield and is good for cooking and producing chips. As the focal point with all Jamaica's international development partners, the PIOJ works with the Rural Agricultural Development Authority, RADA, to ensure that the funds provided by the EU support the country's long-term development goals.
What that means is that RADA now provides that technical support. It provides administrative support to the program to ensure that the funds received from the EU are actually spent on time, effectively, and actually do what they are actually designated to be doing. And so far, the project has actually achieved a lot on the ground.
Among the outcomes of the Jamaica Banana Accompanying Measures program are improvements to the Banana Board's laboratories. The research and development labs were outfitted with the latest equipment to carry out testing on disease samples and develop pesticides. The Banana Board is now able to produce a variety of plantlets from their new tissue culture biofactory. The projection is for the board to produce 120,000 tissue culture plantlets that is to be supplied to participating farmers of the JBAM program per year. A calculated intervention by both the government of Jamaica and the European Union also allowed for the continued operations of the banana breeding station at Bodles in Old Harbour in St. Catherine. The Banana Board currently maintains over 150 varieties of disease-resistant banana plants. Also, JBAM supports the Growers Association through the construction of a $30 million processing plant. This will allow players in the industry to move up the value chain and benefit from the production of banana and planting chips.
And in the future, they can look at other banana products. So we are actually empowering the growers to be involved further along the value chain, which will provide more profit, more income to the Growers Association.
Farmers also benefit from farm suppliers at reasonable rates from stores operated by the All Island Banana Growers Association.
The other thing is the availability. Because of our cash resource, thanks to the EU, we are now in a better position to improve on our inventory. So the availability of input material that is readily available to all farmers. Thirdly, from the assistance given to us, we were able to implement credit programs, which our farmers could get assistance to resuscitate their farms and so forth.
The impact of the JBAM program is far-reaching. Not only are the farmers empowered to produce, but they are able to employ workers, thus spreading the financial gains across rural communities. Another advantage to the farmers is that they get the opportunity to acquire the Global Good Agricultural Practices certification. With this international standard, they are able to trade in the export market. The certification exercise is administered under the sub-program of JBAM, called the Banana Export Expansion Program, BEEP. Its main objectives are to increase banana production with international standards, develop the technical and infrastructural support of the industry, and preserve the industry's competitiveness in both the export and domestic markets.
Well, the assistance that I have gotten is tremendous. We have a huge storeroom that we have compartmentalized to facilitate smooth operation and to prevent contamination and to make us more efficient. By yourself, you would not have been able to.
I've also received over $1.25 million in grant from this program, this B program. And this grant was used as infrastructural development. My farm is now certified as an export farm, so I'm now able to export my own fruit to various overseas countries.
The Banana Board has seen a steady increase in the export of banana and wants to take it further.
Our aim is to increase the overall production by 30%. Last year, we actually did 26%, so we are well on our way.
Export markets currently include the Cayman Islands, Canada, the United States, and the United Kingdom. Looking to the future,
the nature of EU's partnership with Jamaica will mean that we will continue supporting the government and civil society organizations in trying to improve people's lives, and that will be very much also relevant to the agricultural area.
The ministry has been guiding the agricultural sector in terms of growth. We are very proud that the sector has been growing and supporting the Jamaican economy. So our vision is to put the sector in a position through expansion of irrigation, through making available lands with requisite infrastructure, to be able to produce consistently, to tap into a huge tourist market for export, for import substitution, and in the final analysis that our rural spaces and our rural communities are strong because they depend on agriculture. That's our vision.
And that brings us to the end of today's edition of Jamaica Magazine. Join us again tomorrow when we'll do this all over again. Until then, you can click online at jis.gov.jm and visit our YouTube channel to get the latest government information. Also, follow us on Twitter and Facebook and download our app from the Google Play Store to stay informed. I am Adrian Atkinson, wishing for you peace and prosperity. Take care of your health, exercise, eat well, get adequate rest, and make every day a productive one.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.